Hi, my name is Dan Detmeyer with Amphenol Broadband Solutions. Welcome to the Fiber 101 training series. In this series, we're going to be covering multiple sessions covering the basics of fiber. In this session, we'll cover transmitters, receivers, and fiber optic devices. During this training, if you have questions, feel free to put them into the chat. At the end of the training, we'll cover the questions. Fiber optic data is transmitted as pulses of light created by the transmitter with a laser or LED source and received by a photodetector. Here I'm showing a RF signal going into the transmitter. The transmitter takes electrical signal and converts it to light pulses. In the transmitter, this could either be an LED or a laser. It's connected to a fiber optic cable, which transmits the light down the fiber to the optical receiver. The optical receiver has a detector in it that converts the light back into RF energy. A light-emitting diode, which is referred to as an LED, is a semiconductor device that emits light when stimulated by an electric circuit. Instead of generating heat at the PNN junction, which stands for positive and negative, light is generated and passes through an opening or lens. The LEDs convert the electrical signal into light signals so that they may be passed onto the fiber optic cable. They're small and emit a lot of light and make them perfect for multimode applications. They're very easy to use, last longer, and cost less, and are also more reliable. Over on the right is a picture of the LED. You're probably very familiar with these LEDs. You see them in power equipment to indicate that it's on. Also, LED lights in your house, very similar, just a little bit different design for fiber optic applications. A laser diode, LD, is a semiconductor device that emits high power light when stimulated with an electrical current. Over on the right is a picture of this. It looks very familiar to like a hybrid amplifier that you see on a circuit board. But as you can see, it has a little tail, and that's where the light comes out. Laser diodes generate intense light at a very narrow bandwidth. They're used in transmitters for single mode fiber applications, and this is in the cable TV industry. Laser diodes are the most common type of lasers. Next, we're going to look at the difference between an LED versus a laser diode. Edge emitting LEDs, the PNN junction is formed by similar materials with different reactive indexes. The different reactive indexes are used to guide the light and create a directional output. Here in the junction, there's an etched opening, and this allows the light to escape, and it has a wide emission pattern. With the laser, you probably heard the term, it's all smoke and mirrors. With the laser, we're using mirrors. We put a mirror on each side of the junction. On one side of the junction, the mirror is partially reflective. And this allows the light to actually escape. And this actually puts out a very narrow emission pattern and high power. The dominant types of lasers used in single mode systems are fairy-perot, which is FP, and a distributed feedback, DFB. And these are semiconductor lasers. The FP lasers are the original lasers used in the cable industry. It produces light at many wavelengths. It has a wide light pattern, and it's very low cost. And it does have moderate noise and linearity. And these are normally used in the return system. For the DFB lasers, they produce light at a single wavelength, and they're tunable. They have narrow light beams, and the output can be combined with other lasers and then transmitted down the fiber. They're a high cost, but they have less chromatic dispersion than the FP lasers. Let's look at the spectral width of the different lasers. On the bottom, I'm showing the wavelengths, going from 1230 to 1390, and the center's at 1310, and this is just for our example. On the left is the power. The LED is 60 nanometers wide, and the power is 1 milliwatt. So it's a very low power, but very wide. When we look at the FP, we have a very narrow wavelength of 4 millimeters. But the output power is 1 to 2 milliwatts. with the distributed feedback, it has very high power, usually greater than 40 milliwatts, but it has a very narrow wavelength of 1 nanometer. Let's look at the span distances for the different optical lasers. In this chart, I have kilometers at the bottom, going from 0 to 130. And then on the top, I have miles, going from 0 to 80.6. First, we'll look at the multimode. With the LED at 850 nanometers, it has 3.5 dB of loss per kilometer. And it can go about 5 kilometers. We look at the LED at 1300 nanometers, it has 1 dB of loss per kilometer. And this can go about 12 to 13 kilometers. With the FP and the distributed feedback lasers at 1310 nanometers, it has 0.4 of a dB loss per kilometer. And it can go almost 90 kilometers. With the DFB laser at 1550 nanometers, it has 0.3 of a dB loss per kilometer and can go 130 kilometers. Here I'm showing a direct modulated optical transmitter. With the direct modulated lasers, it can shift in frequency, or what's called chirp, when it first turns on, which causes dispersion. Here I'm showing the directly modulated optical transmitter. When the input signal hits the laser, it actually turns the laser on and off to create output pulses of light. Every time the transmitter turns on and off, it can actually cause that chirp or dispersion. To reduce that, we use externally modulated transmitters. We take the laser and we produce a CW light, a continuous wave light. That light then goes into a modulator and creates the pulses of light on the output. There's also a thing called cooled lasers. High power lasers can become unstable as the operating temperature increases. This can affect the power output level and wavelength. It can actually drift. Field application lasers need to shine a light over the same distance as the high power head-end hub lasers and are more prone to noise due to the heat. As atoms heat up, they move more. So technology reduces the speed of the atoms, which in turn reduces the heat generated by the atoms. Here I'm showing an example of some of the optical transmitters. On the left is a single rack-mounted optical transmitter. This takes up a lot of space. So over on the left is the modular optical transmitter. You can put multiple transmitters in one rack. Down at the bottom is a virtual hub. This is something that may be hanging on a strand or in underground vaults. It comes in a housing that's easily accessible through a lid. Never look into the end of an optical connector, adapter, or laser output, as the light can damage your eyes. This light is invisible and you can't see it with the naked eye. Next, we're going to look at erbium doped fiber amplifiers, EDFAs. It's an optical amplifier used to compensate for the loss through the optical fibers in a long distance. Here I'm showing light pulses coming from the transmitter. By the time it gets down the fiber optic cable, it loses too much, and the optical receiver can't distinguish what the information was. That's where erbium doped fiber amplifiers come into play. These can be placed right at the output of the transmitters, or as preamplifiers in front of the receivers. For longer distances, these can be in line. A typical distance between each of the EDFAs is several tens of kilometers. The optical receivers convert the optical light back into electrical signals through the use of photodetectors. Optical receivers usually have wide detector windows and detects all optical modes. Next, we'll look at optical splitters. With the optical fiber just going in one direction, doesn't do us much good. We need to split it off to feed different applications. Fiber splitters are very similar to the RF splitters that we have. They're going to connect devices with 3 or 4 or more devices between them. First, we're going to look at the fused biconical taper splitters, the FBTs. The way we make these splitters is we take two fibers, we bring them together, wrap them around each other, put a little pressure and also heat, and we fuse these fibers together. Once it's fused together, we get rid of the fiber one in this application. So now we have one input and two outputs. The FBT splitters can have up to 4 outputs. In order to get more outputs, we do something similar to the RF splitters. We take a four-way output splitter, optical splitter. In this case, we actually feed four more optical splitters with four outputs. And here we have 16 outputs. And you can get up to 32 outputs here. And that's typically what you have in fiber to the home applications. Next, we're going to look at the planar lightwave circuit, PLC splitters. And these are made very similar to semiconductors. What we do is we take the core glass and we etch it to make light paths. Then we take two cladding glasses over that and make a sandwich. Once it's sandwiched together, it's packaged in a small compact package. These splitters are very compact, efficient, and reliable. Next, we'll look at optical couplers. So there's times when we need more light in one direction than the other. And this would be an optical coupler, again, very similar to our RF couplers. In this example here, I'm showing an input with two outputs at 50% of the light. In order to get different light powers off of one leg versus the other, we can actually shorten that junction where it's fused together. And now we can actually go from 50-50 power, where one leg has 90% power and the other leg has 10%. And these come in various percentages. They can go from 90-10, 80-20, 70-30, and 60-40. Where these optical couplers come into play is in optical taps. We do something very similar to what we do with the RF taps. We take the optical coupler. In this example, I'm using a 1090 optical coupler. We're taking one leg going from the input to the out, and then we have one down leg. The down leg, in this case, feeds a four-way splitter, or it could be a 2 or an 8. So with the 90-10, now we have the input power of 100%. On the output, we have 90%. And then on the coupler down leg, that's where we have 10%. In this example here, we're looking at 80-20. So 100% in, 80% on the output, and 20% feeding down to that four-way splitter. These are very similar to the RF taps. Where these would be used would be up in the air on the street, underground in the street, backyard easements, but we'd have the fiber optic input in one pole, and we'd feed the next pole. In this case, we're going from a 90-10, 20-80, 70-30, and 60-40. Next, we're going to look at multiplexers and demultiplexers. This always reminds me of the Pink Floyd Dark Side of the Moon when I see this. But a multiplexer is a device that combines two or more separate signals from transmission through a single fiber. A demultiplexer allows separation of the signals in the same format as a signal was multiplexed. In this example here, I'm showing a wave division multiplexer and demultiplexer on both sides, and in between is an individual fiber. We have two inputs on each of the multiplexers and the demultiplexers. When we first started using fiber, what we would do is we'd actually take a separate fiber for the forward and a separate fiber for the return. And that wasn't very effective. When we started looking at today's technology, we need a lot of fiber out there. So in order to be more efficient and cost effective, we're actually going to use these multiplexing. So the way this works is here I'm showing a forward signal in the downstream of 1550 nanometers. It goes into the multiplexer, is injected onto the fiber. Then on the other end, which would be a demultiplexer, we bring the signal back out at 1550. On the bottom right there, we have our return signal. So this is the upstream, 1310 nanometers. We put that into the multiplexer on the right, and now it goes onto the fiber. So this fiber now has two wavelengths on it. At the demultiplexer, now it comes back out at 1310 nanometers. So we're going to have multiple wavelengths or information on one fiber. Very efficient, very cost effective. With that technology, that brings us to coarse wavelength division multiplexing, CWDM. This allows up to 18 channels to be multiplexed onto a single fiber. Here I'm just showing an example of some of the wavelengths that you could have. This allows 18 channels available from 1271 nanometers to 1611 nanometers with 20 nanometer cable spacing. To take this one step further, we have dense wavelength division multiplexing, or DWDM. And this allows for 80 channels to be put onto one single fiber. These channels are available from 1530 nanometers to 1565 nanometers with 50 and 100 gigahertz channel spacing. So these are spaced very close together. Let's look at where the CWDM resides versus the DWDM. Here I'm showing 18 CWDM wavelengths in nanometers from 1271 to 1611 nanometers. And now I overlay the DWDM 80 channels. So you can see we can squeeze 80 channels into a very small area. Here's our multiplexer, demultiplexer again. We can have multiple wavelengths on a single fiber. Again, very effective and efficient. Thanks for joining us on this fiber optic session on transmitters, receivers, and fiber optic devices. I'm now going to look at the questions that came in on the chat. I need to switch over to my computer at my desk. So in the meantime, if you have any additional questions, feel free to put them in the chat. All right, let's take a look at the questions that came in on the chat. We got three or four here. The first question is, you mentioned never to look at the end of a laser output. Does this apply to the LEDs? And the answer is yes, it does. You know, even though the LEDs are lower power than the lasers, overexposure can damage the eye. So be very careful. Never look into an open end of a fiber or into a connector or anything like that. You know, always follow your company policy when it comes to safety guidelines when dealing with the fiber. And then, do optical splitters require power? The optical splitters are passive devices, just like the RF splitters. You know, they don't need any power. So same with the optical splitters. There's no active devices in there, so it's just all passive, so it does not require power to operate. And then the next one is, why are wavelengths 1310 nanometers and 1550 nanometers always being used in optical communication systems? And with this is where these wavelengths have the lowest attenuation to them. And with that, you know, if you look at back at our first fiber session that we did, the introduction and theory, we actually covered this. And you can go back there. In fact, you know, we had another question from Damien about if this is, if we could actually download this video. And at this time you can't, but if you go into the link that's provided in the chat, you'll be able to watch this video. And then the other videos in the series are at the bottom of the page. So with that prior question, you know, you can go there, you can look at the first fiber session that we did. And then for this session here, you can watch it again, but at this time you can't download it. Let's see. I think that's about it for the questions there. But you know, hopefully you got something out of this training session. You know, whether this is the third of five or six that we're actually doing, and this series here, we're going to be continuing it. So Amphenol Broadband Solutions, you know, look for reminders of this upcoming session. That'll probably be in a month or so. This is going to be covering part four. And in this session, Charles Dillard's going to be covering the Fiber 101 series when it comes to fiber to the X or fiber to the home technology. So be sure that you look for the invite for that. And again, it'll probably be a month out or so. And we look forward to you joining us in the next session. And again, you know, check that link at the bottom there, and you can look at the previous videos and also this one. So again, thank you very much, and we'll see you next time.